Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Abba Father, we thank you for our spiritual heritage. We ask, Lord, that you preserve it in Jesus' name. We trust you, knowing that you can mold us into all that you ordained us to be on this earth. Lord, you are the potter, and we are the clay. Almighty Lord, we lift up before you the church body. We ask that you pour your Holy Spirit upon each and every one hearing this prayer, O Lord, that we all may know or be assured of who we are and whose we are in Jesus' name. Teach us all, Lord, not to fear the trials and tribulations of the world today, but that we hold firm to your word. Isaiah chapter 41 verse 10 says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." May the Holy Spirit give us all a spirit of boldness, as was given to Daniel when in the lion's den. I pray that faith be increased, Lord, even in persecution. Your word says in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6, that without faith it's impossible to please God. And he who comes to God must believe that he is, that he is the rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Sovereign Lord, Creator of heaven, earth, and the sea, and everything within them, you are our shield and our butler. We will not be afraid of the terrors by night, nor of the arrows that fly by day, nor of the pestilence that walk in darkness. 1,000 may fall at our side, and 10,000 at our right hand, but it shall not come near us. That only with our eyes shall we look and see the reward of the wicked. those who come against your church, because we have made the Lord, who is our refuge, even the Most High, our dwelling place. May we hold steadfast to your word and all your promises, Lord, for you did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. All these things we ask in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Bible reading for today's devotional is taken from 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 5 to 12. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, I am persuaded it is in you also. Therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands, for God has not given us a gift of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us, called us with his holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Jesus Christ before time began, but has now been revealed by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, to which I was appointed a preacher, an apostle, and a teacher of the Gentiles. For this reason I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day. Here ends the Bible reading. Thanks be to God.
devotion today is based on the lesson from 2 Timothy chapter 1. And this is Heritage Month. So this Heritage Month, it is my pleasure to share with you some points of reflection on our heritage. In Ecclesiastes chapter 1, we are told that there's nothing new under the sun. What is, has happened before. So if we do not learn from our past mistakes, we are doomed to repeat the same mistakes again. Many older Methodists would be quick to tell me Methodism was born in sound. But what many do not know or recall is that the pregnancy was full of difficulty, turmoil, and adversity. The success of any project or event depends on the effort and work put into them. And it is the same with our Christian journey in life. In preparing for one of my heritage tours some years ago, I came across a stone. Yes, a rock stone. To put it in the Bajan vernacular, a big rock in a glass case. And it caught my attention. Because this big rock tells a story that should interest every Methodist and give courage to every Christian. In Springhead, Venisbury, in West Midlands in the UK, there is the Venisbury Central Methodist Church and Wesley Centre, where we find the rock on display. The story is that during the years 1743 to 1744, the preaching of the gospel by John Wesley and other Methodists made some people very uneasy. Yes, the gospel would do that to some people. Yes, the word was received gladly by many, particularly the underprivileged. But then, the established church of the land was not happy with the Methodist movement. As a result, some vile acts were inflicted on Methodist women during anti-Methodist riots of the period in Venisbury and the neighboring towns of Walsall, Darlaston, and West Bromwich. It is said that the vicar of the parish, Edward Edgington, was responsible for the riots. The revival movement that took hold in the U.S. through the dynamic preaching of George Whitefield added fuel to the anti-Methodist movement. Consequently, when John Wesley went to preach on September 12th in Leeds, he recorded in his journal that after preaching at 5 in the evening and meeting the society at 8, he was pelted with stones and dirt all the way home, and home being the lodgings he would have been using. However, he returned the next day to find a larger crowd, and the mob came again, but the preaching went on. Persistence in the face of adversity is what this rock can be called. The rocks and the dirt did not hinder the preaching of the gospel, but rather cause more attention and attraction. And what I will clarify and point out is that when the mob raise their anger, they attack women first, which is a bad sign. Also, George Whitefield was the one who introduced John Wesley to field preaching. He took him and told him that field preaching is what he should try. And he took him, yes, to where he would go. Miners, by the mill, wherever crowds would gather. And he made him practice field preaching. And this is why he was so good at it. But George Whitefield went on to the U.S. and he had his own movement out there. And this is where they had dynamic preaching and the movement picked up over there. So when John Wesley at home in England was preaching and making people uneasy over in the U.S., they already had the word what was happening out there. So the established church was not happy. And this will happen whenever the gospel is being preached and people get uneasy. You know that the word of God is touching some raw nerves. Well, in our scripture lesson from 2 Timothy, we read Paul's advice to young Timothy, which was to strengthen him. The early church was also birthed in strong opposition to the gospel being preached, and the early Christians were also harshly treated and despised. Timothy was the pastor of the church in Ephesus. This city, with its pagan religion and laws, made it difficult for the early church to function comfortably. You see, at that time, the emperor in Rome was Domitian, and he considered himself to be a god, and he was the government. He had statues of himself placed at the entrances to the Agora, and the Agora would have been the market. And whenever you entered the market, you had to take a pinch of incense and drop it in the incense burner as an act of worship. So you really were worshiping the emperor every time you entered the market, and this was a requirement, and you could not get away from it. This act was expected of every person who was entering the Agora. There were people watching to see if there were any non-conforming or rebellious citizens. So you see, this spying on each other is nothing new. This spying on each other is used by socialist and communist regimes when they want to push their agenda to make sure that everybody is conforming. Sounds familiar? Failure to pay homage to the emperor would result in your arrest, torture, and even death. The Agora is where all the commerce took place, the selling of food, clothes, and trade. It was your modern-day mall with bakery, butcher shop, hardware store, and supermarket, selling everything from a jackbook to a clipper. Believers who had given their lives to Jesus Christ could not and would not do this sinful act, and so lived in difficult circumstances. If you were a Nicolaitan, it would not be a problem, because the Nicolaitans did not find difficulty in marrying foreign acts with Christian religion. And so this is why Jesus rejected them. And you can find that in Revelation chapter 2. But that is a sermon for another time. In this case, the pressure and adversity on the Christian church there in Ephesus, it sort of made Timothy timid. He got a little scared and timid. And Paul wrote him this letter that we read in 2 Timothy chapter 1. And the famous words in verse 7, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. This is the message for all of us today in our situation that we face. So I don't know what your situation is, but this message is for you. If it's your job, lack of money, if it's a relationship, if it's pressure on you to do something that you don't want to do, God has not given us a spirit of fear. If fear has entered you somehow, get a hold of your Bible, read this passage, and you will find out you can kick fear to the curb. Christians who have died to the world and are alive in Christ, therefore, fear should not be an issue, because you are dead to the world and alive in Christ. If it is not this way with you, check your barometer. Examine your heart and see if it is truly given to Jesus, or if you are still trying to hold on to some part of it. Our heritage as Christians and Methodists is one that saw those before us letting go all for the love of Christ Jesus. Our founder John Wesley rode up and down the length and breadth of England, being challenged by the established church. He was pushed down from a wall. He was abused. He was stoned. So the big rock does have a story to tell after all. Whether it was that rock or another rock, the rock reminds us that we as Christians have a sure rock to stand on, a sure foundation, one we can depend on and boast about. So come, let us exercise what we sing. In the Methodist hymn book 821, we sing, stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory on to victory, his army shall he lead. till every foe is vanquished and Christ is Lord indeed. And I think that all of us would have sung that at some point or other. So it will have now a renewed meaning for us. Also, we have another hymn which should hold dear as it speaks of who we are. And it is, "Who is on the Lord's side?" And verse 4 states, "Chosen to be soldiers in an alien land, chosen, called, and faithful for our captain's band. In the service royal, let us not grow cold. Let us be right loyal, noble, true, and bold. Master, thou wilt keep us by thy grace divine, always on the Lord's side, Savior, always thine." These are hymns and a message of hope about those who have gone before us, letting us know that fear is not something we should fear, but we should put fear to flight. Also, take heart from the gospel and from the words of the hymns that we sing, that we boast of so. If we say Methodism was born in song, then we sing these hymns faithfully because they are written, they're sung, and we should rejoice when we sing them. I pray that this will be your stand in time and place where you are. For our Heavenly Father has placed us here in this time and in this space where we are to work for Him. So, if you are idle, check yourself. There's a lot of work to be done, and God is calling all of us to do our portion and our part, even at this time. This message is for all of us, and for all of you, whoever you are, wherever you are, the message is the same. We have a good heritage. The early church had a good heritage. They had difficulties. They overcame them. We will have difficulties, and we also will overcome them once we put Jesus in front of us and bring Him into everything we do. So this message today is not only for Methodists, but for all Christians. This message is to give you the understanding of who we are. And I pray that this month that we call Heritage Month, we will truly, truly look at our heritage and see that the difficulties which we had before, we can learn from and do not repeat the same mistakes. God bless you all.
Oh. Do not fret because of the wicked. Do not be envious of wrongdoers, for they will soon fade like the grass and wither like the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good, and you will live in the land and enjoy security. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will act. He will make your vindication shine like the light, and the justice of your cause like the noonday. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret over those who prosper in their way, over those who carry out evil devices. Refrain from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret. It only leads to evil. For the wicked shall be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord shall inherit the earth. And now, brothers and sisters, our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God, even our Father, who has loved us and has given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace, may he comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and in every good work. And the people of God say, Amen.
Of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to his word and may it dwell in all of us richly.